The entrance hymn that we sang reminds us that harvest time, the end of the year, is also a time in which the church thinks about the end of history itself, the end times, the last things. And so in these Sundays leading up to the feast of Christ the King, and even into the first reading, the week of Advent, we hear accounts about how Christ will come again and he will judge us. So, picking up on the theme of encounter, which has been the central focus for yesterday and today, I'd like to meditate with you a little bit about how encountering Jesus is always, in particular, about encountering him as we say in the Creed, the one who will come to judge the living and the dead. The risen Christ is the Lord of history. The judgment of the world and the consummation of everything that God has planned is in the hands of his incarnate Son, Jesus Christ. And so when we meet the Lord, when we encounter Jesus, we encounter him as this judge. And as I've thought about the scripture today, I think there are at least these four, we might say, attitudes or approaches or insights into our encountering Jesus as the judge of the end time. These four attitudes. Don't check out, don't lose focus, don't panic, and don't be intimidated. St. Paul, in the epistle, and our Lord certainly in the gospel, coaches us and advises us to make these part of our approach to meeting Christ, the judge of the living and the dead. Now, we could think about these attitudes as they have shown up throughout all of history and the times of the church's persecutions, for example, or other cataclysmic events. But I'd like to focus our attention on each of our own personal histories. I'd like to talk a little bit about how in my history and your history, mine is Alan, yours is Mary or John or Mark or Alejandro, whoever, these four kinds of attitudes are called for. This is the way a disciple meets the judge of the living and the dead, Jesus Christ risen. So St. Paul says in the epistle, my words, summing it up, don't check out. That's what he said about himself, that he kept working. And he urges the Thessalonians to keep being part of the ordinary fabric of life. That's what it means to work. You make a living, you get up, you do your duty, you buy food, there's a house to be taken care of. You don't check out. Now, this has happened very pointedly in some periods in the history of the church, that people, because they expected the end of time, have checked out of participating in the ordinary events of society and life. But we can do this even in our own way today. We can be tempted to withdraw from the messiness of the world. We can, because we know that Christ is Lord and there awaits for us at the end of history the perfect consummation where everything will be right, to decide, well, if it's all going to be right in the end, I'm not going to bother with tomorrow or the next day. At least I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to care. I'm not going to be involved. Or another way to another way to check out is to say, because it's imperfect, I won't really be a part of anything that's going on. Our Lord, through Paul, is calling on us to be about our ordinary business of life. My history, your history. Now, not to be about that in the way that unbelievers are, but indeed to participate in our community, to be a part, just as Paul was. Then the three attitudes that I find Jesus preaching in the gospel as he talks about the end of time. First of all, he says, don't lose focus. He predicts that one day the temple would be destroyed. And he wants his disciples to understand that even though something like that was on its way, they didn't need to lose their focus on what's important. They needed to focus on him. And I think this is particularly important for us as we try to make our transition from maintenance to mission. Now, today it isn't the stones of the temple that seem to be falling apart, but there are things that we hold dear that are being dissolved, that are coming undone. We face that. But our Lord is telling us, as we think about our own history and his being the Lord of history, the Lord of the history of the Archdiocese of Detroit, the Lord of my history and your history, the Lord of our parishes and our schools and all our institutions. Don't lose focus. Things come and they go. The temple was built and the temple fell apart. It happens. But in history, Jesus is Lord. He's on his throne. And he moves all things toward its perfect consummation. So when we meet Jesus, when we encounter him as the judge of the living and the dead, we have to keep our focus. He also tells us when we meet him and recognize him as the judge of the living and the dead, we shouldn't panic. He said, there will be wars, conflict, and there will be natural disasters in the unfolding of history. He says it, but he affirms that he's still the Lord, and at the end, it will all be made right. And so today, we have our own experience of natural disasters, and certainly we have our experience of civil conflict, the contentions we live with, the things that sometimes even seem to be pulling our society apart. But the Lord of history, Jesus, the Lord of my history and yours, when we meet him, as we encounter him, reminds us not to panic, that he has been and always will be in charge. And no matter how things may look, they are progressing to the fulfillment that is preordained by the Father. The second attitude that Jesus invites us to have when we meet him and encounter him as risen and the judge of the living and the dead is not to be intimidated. He foretells that any one of us who is his disciple will suffer persecution and difficulty and contradiction and hurt for confessing his name. Certainly we think of past dramatic persecutions, the persecutions of the Roman Empire, the persecutions of the last century by totalitarian regimes, whether they were National Socialist or Communist. But that's not only about those people or long ago. We ourselves face pressure. We are often ridiculed for the confession we make of the name of Jesus Christ and what he teaches us about the dignity of human life, for example. The evil of abortion and euthanasia, what Jesus teaches us about human sexuality, about the nature of marriage, what Jesus teaches us about justice, the need to care for the poor and those who are at the margins. For all of these things, you and I, in our personal history, because we have encountered the Lord risen, the judge of the living and the dead, are often signs of contradiction. And you see, there are even attempts in our own day to make us illegitimate, to take away from medical students, for example, the legitimacy of their practice because they don't conform to what the world says about medical ethics. Many of you face contradiction where you work or in your neighborhood, perhaps even in your family, for what you confess as you have met Jesus as risen and the Lord of death and life. Jesus' advice to us is don't be intimidated. We will be vindicated. He will come again. He will make all right. Our job is to persevere. Our job is not necessarily to conquer, but to be faithful. So that's about encounter. And it is in these dispositions of not checking out, not losing focus, not panicking, and not being intimidated that we all need to grow. This is how a disciple develops, to become ever more trusting in the power of Christ to direct history to its perfect fulfillment when true justice shapes the world. And it is then our witness. Jesus talks about that, how being faithful to him and accepting his lordship gives us the opportunity to testify to the world, to who he is and what he will do for us. And this is ultimately a testimony, a witness to freedom. Because we have encountered Jesus as the Lord of history, the Lord of my history, who assures the triumph of my destiny, we can be free. We don't have to calculate everything. We can always do what's right and have confidence that Christ will vindicate me, vindicate you, and bring you home safely. In the Eucharist, then, Jesus establishes his lordship in our midst today. When the Holy Spirit comes down on the bread and wine and transforms them into the body and blood of Christ, he makes whatever place, whatever altar that happens on, an outpost of the victory of Jesus risen from the dead, the judge of the living and the dead. We hear dramatic stories, for example, about how prisoners, even in concentration camps, huddled together to celebrate the Eucharist. And in that place, at that moment, whatever was the enemy of the kingdom of Christ was vanquished. Wherever the Eucharist is celebrated, Christ is victorious. And wherever the Eucharist is celebrated, the lordship of Jesus is affirmed by those who gather there together. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim that the death of Jesus brings victory for Jesus and for all of us. And we do this until he comes again. And it is at that time which will come surely in God's appointed rhythm We do this confident that in the end all will be made right. Justice will reign and Christ will be king forever. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world.